This week, our castaway is the tenor Giuseppe di Stefano. Signor di Stefano, have you ever imagined yourself on a desert island?
Well, I come from an island. I come from Sicily, you know.
That's quite a big island.
That's a big island. Only 6 million people, you know.
Yes, not quite the same. Not what we had in view.
No.
Could you endure loneliness?
Well, not me. It would be tough for me.
You like people around.
Yes.
Now, you have just 8 records, which may have to last a very long time. Any 8 you like. What's the first one?
Well, being Sicilian and coming from an island, I've loved one Sicilian song.
Yes.
And this Sicilian song, which the English audience particularly always loved, I recorded this many years ago, is called Mutetti di Lupaglio.
What does that mean?
Means like the Palio in Siena, you know, that's a very famous horse races in Siena, the Palio. See, this is a horse races in Palermo, Sicily.
In Sicily.
It is a song of victory.
And it's a folk song.
It's a folk song.
Cavaggiuzzi vanni quarto, unni babbate rabbarato. Uie, uie. Umarativi porta felici, mi va pigliare la gola madrina.
A Sicilian folk song to start with. You didn't stay in Sicily very long, did you?
No, until 5 and a half. Then, with my mother, we joined my father, who was in Milan already, in the north.
Yes.
And there I've been all my life.
Your father was in the Carabinieri, wasn't he?
My father was a Carabinieri, my mother was a dressmaker. So music, it was a real Sicilian style.
Was there music in your home?
Nobody knew anything about music. As a matter of fact, when I started to talk about making to become a tenor, they almost threw me out of the house. What is that? Something to eat? I said, no, the tenor. It's somebody who sings and makes money with singing. I don't believe, said my father. You better be another Carabiniere, you better do something different. But what is this tenor?
You did sing in the church choir as a boy.
Yes, I did sing, but never aroused any enthusiasm from my parents. They never came, they never cared about that. Mm. But a young man who was 4 years older than me, that means he was 19, 20, he became my friend because he loved opera. He was one of these opera fans.
Yes.
And one day while we were playing cards and he was singing all the time because he was very lucky. So I had to listen all the time opera arias. As a matter of fact, the first opera arias I learned from him. One day finally he lost. And he lost while he took a long breath to sing the high note of La Donna Mobile, which stayed in his throat. And I won in that particular moment. So I sang the high note. Pensier! A big high note. Yeah. For the first time, I mean, by the time we had this friendship, I was already 16, see? So my voice grew a lot from the very first time he heard me in the church. And then, instead of getting mad, he was so happy, was surprised, what a voice you have. Maybe you should sing opera. Tomorrow I bring it to a teacher and...
So you took his advice, you took lessons... And you began going to the opera house.
Well, it's not that easy, because I hate opera.
You hate opera?
I love to go to dance every night with my friend. I love songs. I didn't care about opera. But finally he got me one night in the Scala, and I thought I had to go if I want to be a tenor, because every night was telling me that I had a very pretty voice and this and that. But I thought he was talking out of friendship. I didn't believe for 1 second that all this would become true. So one night, finally, I went with him, and the first experience was Turandot, and I didn't like it at all. But a few weeks later, I heard Beniamino Gigli, always in the Scala, in Poliuto from Donizetti. And then when I heard the voice of Beniamino Gigli, I went wild. I started to love him and to love the opera. And then later I loved Schipa, who was even a better musician than the great Gigli.
And then you took lessons. You went to the conservatoire?
Yes, but only to study music. So I studied contrabasso, you know, the big
double bass,
exactly. Mm-hmm. But just to learn music. And during that time, I met Gigli. I mean, I went to his hotel. I wanted to shake his hand. But when he was in front of him, I was so full of emotion, I could not talk. I said, "Mamma maestro." I said, "Yeah, calma. I said, "What do you want? I would like to sing for you." I said, "What are you studying?" "I'm studying the conservatorio di Milano." But he said, "Ma tomorrow I'm coming to the conservatorio to give a lesson, a master class, and then you will sing for me, okay?" "Okay, ciao, bye." Yeah. So I left him. But I forgot to tell him that I was a student of double bass. See, so the next day I heard him, but I could not sing. I was not a vocal student.
Let's have your second record. What do we have next?
Well, I would love to play the maestro, Toscanini, together. Me with the maestro, I mean, in Verdi's Requiem, that I had the great joy and honor to sing with him in the 50 years anniversary of Verdi's death in New York, in the Carnegie Hall. Mm-hmm. So this will be Ingemisco from the Verdi's Requiem.
Ingemisco tanquam re
recording of the Ingemisco from Verdi's Requiem, the NBC Symphony Orchestra conducted by Arturo Toscanini. Now, before you could start your singing career, you had to go into the army, I believe.
Yes, of course. I was not looking for, but I had to.
Where were you stationed?
I was in near Milano, Alessandria, in Piemonte.
And what was your job in the army?
Well, my job was to be a soldier. Yes. And it was a tough one because I was in the artillery. And then it was very easy to catch in cold, you know. So one day I started to go to the infirmary and ask the doctor what I could do because I was afraid of my voice. Already I knew by the time that I could have a future in the opera. I had won a couple of singing contests. I made an audition in the Scala with Maestro Gino Marinuzzi. They all predicted that I had a future. So every morning marching, you know, 40 kilometers, 50 kilometers, 20 kilometers, in the snow, in the rain. This was bad. I didn't like it. I would have preferred a car, you see. the car. So I went to the doctor and tried to get a more comfortable life out of it. And so he hated me. When he saw me every day, he used to call me lavativo, which means that every day there's a group of those guys who never, they don't want to march or they don't want to do the heavy. But I never told him that I was a singer. He hated me and, excuse. He just hated me. But one day, a corporal, who was a chauffeur of the colonel, my regiment, came in the room where I was waiting for the doctor. And the doctor saw him and immediately became another man. He started to smile. "Oh, my friend Garagozzo, sing something for me." See, I forgot to tell you, the doctor was Neapolitan. And he loved singing, but I didn't know. See, so when Garagozzo came, he started to smile, he became another man, and said, "Sing something for me." This Garagozzo, who still is alive and is a taxi driver in Siracusa, Sicily, This Garagozzo told, "But dottore, how can I sing in the presence of Giuseppe di Stefano?" Because he loved me very much. We used to sing together in the osterie, so he knew my voice, and he thought I was a great tenor. So he thought, "How can I sing in front of Giuseppe di Stefano?" And the doctor said, "Who is Giuseppe di Stefano?" "Well, that guy there, the fellow there." Again, the doctor, when he saw me, he became very dramatically serious. He was mad again. "That guy is not possible. I hate him. It's not possible that he sings well." Well, he asked me to sing. And I never obey an order like that one. I sang immediately. I remember che Gesù Manina, and from that moment he got me away from the battalion where I was on heavy duty, and he asked me to stay in the infirmary with him. So I said, here you'll be very comfortable, you can take care of your voice, and one thing, you will sing for me when I get mad. You know, I get mad very easy, because the Lava TV like you, we have plenty here, so you will sing when I get mad. But I didn't know he was getting mad so often. You know, so it was another heavy job, but it was inside, see?
At one point, they were going to send you off to the Eastern Front, weren't they?
Yeah, we were supposed to go together with my regiment.
Against the Russians?
Against the Russians.
That was serious.
It was very serious, I mean. That's why I sang good with the doctor. I was always in good, trying to convince him that I had a future. And that, you know, said, doctor, what do you think? Russia is going to be very bad for my voice. So shut up, you're going to come with me. You're going to come with me, because who's going to sing for us in Russia in the night when we are all alone in the steppe, in the snow? Remember, the doctor said, you know, Garagozzo, the chauffeur of the colonel, he doesn't sing bad, you know, he's got a pretty voice too. Never mind, sempre, you are always the same lavativo. I was kidding, but, you know, I was trying, you know. And so... when the order came to go to Russia, my mother came and said goodbye, and I was ready to leave with him. But out of the blue sky, the same morning the regiment left, he called me, and he told me that he could not sleep all night, and he had a big problem in his conscience, and he thought that it would be better that I stay. As a soldier, I was nothing special, he said. So maybe you stay here, and one day you will sing for our country. You'll be our Italian singer, tenor, you see. And that he left, and the poor guy, he died as a hero in Russia.
Anyway, you were able to stay in Milan. You sang in a cinema for a while, didn't you?
But this was during the war, exactly. When the regiment left for Russia, this dottore wrote to me from Russia. And then he told his colleague in Alessandria, said, let him give a couple of months of... rest, as I was tired. The poor guy was thinking about me that I should go to Milan and study a little bit. So I had 2 months of convalescence, and I went to Milano. In that moment, my parents were very poor, and the money was with a big inflation. So I tried to help them, to help the family, singing songs.
And you were singing pop songs.
It made a big success. I made the first records. Mm-hmm. It's Nino Florio. That's the way it started, Nino Florio. Yeah. But then after 2 months, I went back to the army. And then the German came, so I escaped with the help of a German soldier telling him that I was an opera singer. Yes. And the night he helped me to escape, and then I went to Switzerland, and then I started to sing.
Right. Dodged the Russians, and now you dodged the Germans, so let's break at this point for another record. What shall we have?
When I sang with Toscanini, I was staying in the Hotel Elysee in New York, and in the same hotel, Horowitz was living.
Oh, the pianist.
In 1951, pianist. And, you know, Horowitz is the son-in-law of Toscanini. So they had a great joy to know him personally. And one night I was invited to a concert at the Carnegie Hall that Horowitz gave there on the 51. But, boy, what a pianist. I went to this concert. I was so impressed from this da capo that he did. I would like to play it now.
This was his uncle.
Yes.
Stars and Stripes Forever. Now, Giuseppe di Stefano, you were safe and sound in Switzerland. Was it difficult to get over the mountains?
No, over the mountains. It was simple through the Stresa, which is a small river. Mm. And around that September, there was not much water.
Were you interned?
As a soldier, I was a corporal. So I was interned there 2 months.
You said you were a very bad soldier, and now you're a corporal. You couldn't have been all that bad.
No, but I became a corporal in Switzerland because I always wanted to be a corporal. Anybody can say anything. Such a confusion in that moment.
You said you were a corporal. Yes, good.
Yes. I want to say captain when they ask me. They're very ambitious, see? But when I was trying to say cap, there was somebody who knew me as Nino Florio. He said, ciao, Nino. So I said, caporale, instead of captain, you see?
But they let you go on singing?
No, when I was in the camp, mm-hmm. I'm very shy. Now I am with age. after a career, I became a little more open. But in those years, I was very shy. And when we were in the camp, the Swiss people used to come with chocolate, cigarette. I was getting nothing. Because I was always the last one. But so one day I start to sing. And when I start to sing, everybody came, all the Swiss people were looking for me. So I had chocolate and cigarette that I opened the store in the camp, you see. And meanwhile, I start to smoke. And this was bad because I had so many cigarettes, nothing to do in the camp. So I pick up smoking. But it didn't hurt me to smoke until later because I was already a man. I mean, 22 years old. Mm. I didn't start very young. So for many years, it didn't bother me to smoke. But then after, it did bother me. But from the camp, a corporal brought me to Zurich for an audition. And there I made an audition in the Staatsoper.
Yes.
In the opera theater in Zurich. So all around the camp, they knew about this young tenor. And one Swiss man, who, by the way, was born in Palermo, so he spoke fluent Italian, he was vice director of the radio in Lausanne. Mm-hmm. And he asked the Swiss government to let me free to be able to sing and study in Lausanne. So I was very fortunate. Those were the best years of my life.
Yes.
See, because they spoiled me, the Swiss. You know, I started to sing the first operas, and even EMI. I made my first records for EMI.
Yes, those early records must be very rare and valuable now, the ones you made in Switzerland.
1944, yes.
Yes. You stayed in Switzerland.
It's finished in 1944 for us. I went back in 1945, mm-hmm. in the summer. Less than 8 months later, I was on stage.
I have a note here which says that on April the 20th, 1946, you made your debut as Decouilleur in Massenet's Manon. Which theatre was that in?
This was in Reggio Emilia in the north of Italy.
How long before you sang in La Scala?
Now, 11 months after, I sang in the Scala. And 10 months later, in 1948, I was just singing in the Met already, Rigoletto.
Right. Well, at that point, let's have your fourth record. What's that to be?
Well, now, you know, being in an island, I think that I don't want to hear... I like to hear very sweet music, full of atmosphere. So I would like to play Mahler.
Yes?
The Adagio of the Fifth Symphony, I think.
The Adagietto from Mahler's Fifth Symphony, the New Philharmonia Orchestra conducted by Sir John Barbirolli. Now, you made your debut in the Metropolitan, New York. You sang regularly there for years. Which celebrated ladies did you sing opposite at the Met?
Well, I sang with Lily Pons, Licia Albanese, Vidu Sayao.
Oh, yes.
All the lyric soprano, because I was a very lyric tenor. You see, the French repertoire I used to do. Mignon with the beautiful Risa Stevens, American mezzo soprano.
And in Sao Paulo, you sang opposite a lady who was to be very celebrated indeed and a very good friend of yours.
Yes, that was Maria Callas.
What was the opera?
That was Traviata, but it was a rare occasion, you know. The big season was in Rio de Janeiro. In those years, 48, 49, 50, 51, they had the biggest season in the world. I mean, the season with all the most expensive, the best singers that were in the world in that moment. Of course, they had Callas and Tebaldi together in the same season. So you can imagine the fight was going on. So there's such a fight in Rio. But then we went to São Paulo. And in São Paulo, they offered two Traviata to me to sing. One with Tebaldi and one with Callas. So you can imagine, they didn't even know the tenor. Who was the tenor? Who was the baritone? They were trying to out-sing each other, you know? Tebaldi was very big in that moment, beautiful voice, and she was singing with beautiful technique. It was in top condition. Mm. So it was, and Callas too, so you can imagine what kind of Traviata I was in. But Maria always forgot. 6 months later, we were in Mexico, and there in Mexico, we sang five operas together. So for Maria, always, our first time we sang together was in Mexico. She didn't remember anything about the San Paolo Traviata.
Too preoccupied with Tebaldi.
Yes, and there was only one night, no rehearsal, you know, just jumping in, boom. And,
yes.
And maybe I didn't make a big impression. What can I tell you?
And you began recording operas with Maria Callas. Where did you record them?
First opera in Milano.
Yes.
Because in those years, London Decca was starting to make operas, but I refused. I didn't accept with Tebaldi. Mm. I was supposed to make a record with London Decca with Tebaldi, but we didn't reach an agreement economically. So with Milano for the Scala, I was so lucky that EMI was starting this big program with Maria Callas, and then I was free to accept. And that's what happened.
Well, I've got a list of 10 of them here that you recorded with Callas. You still hadn't made your debut in Britain.
No, my debut in Britain is many years after. It was in 1961, 63. In Tosca and in Bohème.
Yes.
Tosca was not bad, and I did three performances, but Bohème, I was in a little trouble with my windpipe. So I only sang one performance.
Let's have another record.
Well, since we speak about Callas, what about one of the most beautiful moments of enjoyment for me in my career was to do Puritani with Maria, because in the second act, when I was not on stage, but from my dressing room, I could listen the most beautiful singing of Maria in Qui la voce sua soave, in the second act of Puritani from Bellini, and Bellini is from Catania, I am from Catania.
Maria Callas in an aria from Bellini's I Puritani. At one time, you said that you had sung a lot of opera, but on the whole, you preferred recitals and concerts because you didn't get as much interference from conductors and directors.
Yes, that's true.
You still prefer the concert hall?
Yes. See, I need a lot of rehearsals in the opera, and I need also an old-fashioned conductor, the one who looks in your eyes, smiles, mumming the words, you know, to inspire me, to sing together, if you will. It's not easy to express. We were used to this kind. Maestro Serafini used to smile all the time because this smiling, the scuola del sorriso, smiling, is the real school of singing. And the same Toscanini was guiding me with the eyes, mm-hmm. See, and the Sabbath the same. Then And then we had Karajan, you know, great conductor, but a different style. So I have to adjust to this style. They don't guide you. I need to be guided, because I think that's a very tough job. You have to remember words, notes, movements. So you need a little help from the conductor. Now the conductor don't care about too much about the words, about the interpretation. They look always very serious. In any case, I enjoy with the piano because I have a direct contact with the public. Mm-hmm. I even tell jokes sometimes when the atmosphere is very, very warm, you know.
Yes.
Not before I sing. When everything is going fine, then I enjoy myself too, explaining the songs.
It's time we had another record. We've got to your sixth.
Yes. Recently in New York, I was so lucky to listen to Perlman.
Isaac Perlman.
The violinist, Isaac Perlman. And I love him so much. I love artists. I enjoy the music, you know. So now I would like to hear my Italian composer, Vivaldi, play and conducted by Perlman. And this will be the second movement of the fourth season of Vivaldi.
Which season?
Autumn.
The second movement of Autumn from Vivaldi's The Four Seasons, Isaac Perlman conducting the London Philharmonic Orchestra. Well, what are you up to now? What's your next move? You're going to direct an opera?
Well, I will do that. I always said that between the age of 40 and 60, I will have fun, because I think a man has many interests in life. From 14 to 60.
Certainly.
When I'll be 60, I go back to the opera, I said, because then I have less interest in life, I go back to my first love, opera. And I said this, of course, that is for fun, or to make my critics mad. But by destiny there again, in last December, I made my debut in the opera after 5 years that I didn't sing opera. And this was in New York singing Elisir d'Amore. I stopped smoking for 1 month, and Actually, I sang the performance, and I was very happy. It is a sign of youth, a sign of health, to be able to sing an opera like Elisir d'Amore, because it takes a lot of breath.
You still stop smoking. I haven't smoked at all since I've been with you.
Of course, I don't smoke anymore. So the word spread out in Italy that I was not smoking, so they engaged me immediately in Palermo. I went down. I don't left. They even invited me in Glasgow in January. They telephoned me, Milano, to join them in a benefit concert for the earthquake in Italy. I'm going now to Palm Springs, which I love, the desert, you know, the heat. I need this to clean up, really, for good, my windpipe from smoking, you see. And now I come back and, boom, I will sing everything.
Good. We've got two more records to choose. What's number seven?
I will play the singers I love most in pop music.
Yes.
The first one is Barbara Streisand. And since I love people, you know already what kind of song you're going to listen.
Lovers are very special people.
Barbara Streisand and people. You're on this island. Could you look after yourself? Are you good with your hands? Could you build somewhere to live?
This would be tough, but I'll do my best.
You're not very good about the house.
No.
No.
But I'm good on doing my washing, you see. So I hope I can bring my soap, maybe English soap, and do my washing.
All right, you're going to be clean. Are you going to be well fed? Have you ever done any fishing?
No, I cannot fish.
Do you know anything about small boats?
Well, I can build a, I don't know, maybe a raft. Something.
You can build a raft?
Well, anybody can do if you want to get rid of an island.
That's what you think. Yes. Right. You built a raft. Would you try to escape on it?
I think I although I love silence, but I love people, you see.
Yes.
And I mean only women. I mean men, women, everybody.
So you would have a shot. You would attempt an escape.
If I am alone, yes, of course.
Right. Yeah. What's your last record?
Well, the other singer that I love so much, the Nat King Cole, in a song that is called This Is All I Ask.
Beautiful girls, walk a little slower when you walk by me. Lingering sunsets, stay a little longer with the lonely sea.
Nat King Cole,
yes.
This is all I ask. If you could take only one disc of the eight you've chosen, which would it be?
As I said before, in my dressing room, the most beautiful moment when Callas was singing the Qui la voce sua soave.
I Puritani.
I Puritani. So that will be, it's part of my life. This.
Right.
And the composer, Bellini, my favorite composer.
Sicilian.
Sicilian, from Catania, like me.
Right.
So that will be Qui la voce sua soave.
And one luxury to take to the island.
Well, I will take that damn roulette, you know, that, you know, roulette?
Roulette, yes. Yeah? Yes.
It drives me crazy, the little ball. when I gamble, that's a duo.
You're fond of gambling, aren't you?
Not gambling. I hate gambling. I love roulette. No, it's to enter in this world of craziness, of disorder, because she doesn't obey any rule, this little ball. If you enter this world and you find out that 2 hours before, 25 came, and after came 33. And 2 hours after, 25 comes, and 33 comes again. That happened many times. Mm. So that means that in such a disorder, that's an order. And this excites me.
Right. Now, you're allowed to have one book on the island. You already have the Bible and Shakespeare.
Well, since I didn't read it yet, I would like to take with me this Maria, the book that Arianna Stasinopoulos wrote. See, I still didn't read it, so I will take this with me.
All right, Maria by Arianna Stasinopoulos.
Exactly.
And thank you, Giuseppe di Stefano, for letting us hear your Desert Island discs.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.
Bye.